Hello, ladies and gentlemen. It's the Historical Gamer once again, and today is going to be another discussion on Germany, its politics, and the falling out that occurred between the German Empire and the British Empire. First, real quick summary of what's going on here. The Russians have launched a massive offensive on Eastern Prussia here at the start of 1915. It is the winter, and it seems as in every history book as well, the Russians fight best in the winter. You can see there are just masses of Russian soldiers approaching my forces in Eastern Prussia. I've already lost at least two units. I do have a Prussian or a Russian unit there cut off that'll probably be destroyed, but there's just so many more. Just look at all of these Russian units on this front. They're just overwhelming me, and I don't have a whole lot of reserves coming, so I basically have to fight with what I have. The bad news is my artillery here is directly bordering the Russian soldiers, and that's never good. And the other thing that isn't good is I've got a very thin strip of defenses before I end up getting thrown into the sea or losing Eastern Prussia, one or the other. So I kind of had to move that infantry unit forward, but it doesn't have any trenches, and now it's a garrison unit that'll be able to be attacked by two full-sized Russian units. So it might have been better leaving them back there along the border, but or along the in the trenches. But at the very least there, you can see I just destroyed a Russian army unit, so I don't know, maybe the morale will cause them to fall back. I'm not sure. The Austrian down there still doing okay. The Russians aren't giving much effort to them, except the Austrians have so many troops deployed to Serbia that they don't have enough troops to really do anything against the Russians. Meanwhile, on the Western Front, things aren't going great either. We'll take a look at that in a little bit. But real quick here, you can see the Austrians have, what, five units along the front here. The Russians have five just facing Przemysl. And, you know, we could possibly advance from Krakow, but I don't know where to. Maybe this unit could go up here and try and lend a hand, but we'll see. Moving down onto the Serbian front there, you can see the Serbians are pretty spread out, and we are beating them, if ever so slowly. I do have one unit I can bring in here, so I guess I'll put that army unit, was that near Leipzig or something like that? But you can see the Serbians are pretty spread out. They are being defeated slowly but surely. I've been using my navy to bombard their troops here. As long as they remain in that little green area there in home waters, which means if the Allies bring a fleet in, we're at a substantial advantage. I'm not sure how historic or accurate that is to give navies a huge advantage in their own home waters. I don't know if that's supposed to simulate, you know, coastal ships, which aren't simulated here, maybe like coastal battleships or something like that. But it seems a little bit preposterous. You know, if the German fleet sailed out and faced the British, they'd be at a disadvantage whether they're 20 miles offshore or whether they're 200 miles offshore. And especially in the Adriatic, where the Austrians and Italians are in such close proximity, almost every single fight would be fought in one of those areas. So I'm not sure how that'll be simulated, if at all. But you can see here, I guess they weren't as spread out as I thought they were. The Serbians do have a coherent front line again, it would appear. Although up near Tempsburg, that city which they took from us, does look a little bit vulnerable there. It could kind of split the gap there with those troops. And at least down here in the south, the majority of Austrian or of Serbian units are garrison units. So we do have that advantage on our side as well. So as far as that's concerned, we'll go ahead and upgrade these units. Now, I kind of rambled a bit in my last video about Kaiser Wilhelm and his perception of Germany and kind of this feeling of neglect, of Germany being ignored by the major powers, and that Germany didn't really get the respect it deserved. And real quickly, going over here to the Western Front, everything looks in general okay and solid, with one exception. The French may be, and hopefully they're not going to press it, kind of sneaking around our front line there down on the bottom right-hand corner. And the Turks, they're doing okay. They've got pretty good defenses built up. I need to do something with Turkey, though. Maybe launch an offensive against the Caucasus. I don't know. I mean, it's just, there's one Russian unit there advancing, but it feels like it's an area that we could exploit. But, yeah. So as I was saying, Kaiser Wilhelm had this feeling of almost inadequacy, like Germany wasn't getting the respect it deserved, and that something had to be done about that. And, you know, it's almost this inferiority complex of why aren't we getting treated equally as everyone else? I want to be part of the cool kids club. I want to be part of the emperor's club. You guys need treat me like a friend. Treat me like your own. Respect me as an equal. And there's this sense of it's almost childlike in Wilhelm's demeanor, in that he wants to be regarded as an equal. He wants to be respected. It's not that he wants to overthrow the British Empire as the preeminent empire, but he wants the British to treat him as an equal. He wants the British to say, yes, Germany, you are our equal. You are on equal footing as us, and we will give you all the respect and the credit that you think you deserve. And I think that's a little bit unrealistic for Germany, a traditional continental power that has less than 30 years of history at the time that Wilhelm ascends to the throne as an empire, to all of a sudden be treated by the reigning superpower, undisputed superpower in 1890 especially. I think people, when you talk about how powerful the United States is relative to everyone else, you could easily argue that England was in that exact same position in 1890 or 1888 when Kaiser Wilhelm took power. England was in that exact same position that the United States is today, where no one else could even hold a candle to their power. Their army was by far the best trained, although not the largest, so admittedly there they were behind the Germans, where there really isn't anyone in front of the U.S. I mean, China's military is bigger, but the quality isn't, it wouldn't be comparable to where the Germans were at the time. Where you almost have this just undisputed, they could do whatever they want, and they've been in charge doing whatever they want for close to 200 years by the time that Kaiser Wilhelm ascends to power. So for him to think that all of a sudden, just because Germany has expanded and grown in the last 30 years to be taken as an equal as Britain or even France is certainly a little bit naive, but the Kaiser had his own sort of personality issues. He may have certainly had some disorders. He definitely had this sort of, as I said, an inferiority complex. And it shows, you know, he immediately changed tact of Germany. I talked briefly about it under Otto von Bismarck from 1862, I believe it was, all the way through 1890. He was the Chancellor of Germany. Most of that time under the Kaiser's grandfather, Wilhelm I. And under that time, Germany had been practicing a policy called Realpolitik, which basically just means power politics, maybe Machiavellian politics, essentially the idea of realistic politics. So Bismarck's main focus was isolating France and protecting Germany from the threat of a two-front war. In fact, Wilhelm I, the grandfather of Kaiser Wilhelm II, was muttering something, and I'm not 100% sure on it, but was basically talking about avoiding a two-front war on his deathbed. You know, that was the big fear for the Kaiser. And Bismarck had done a remarkable job as chancellor practicing these realistic political objectives, you know, especially he was very pragmatic. He decided when they defeated Austria in a war against Austria earlier in his reign, that they're not going to take any territory from Austria. They certainly humiliated the Austrians, who were supposed to be the preeminent German power. It ended up becoming Germany after that, or Prussia, but they didn't seize any territory. When Germany defeated France in 1870, Bismarck very practically and pragmatically said, listen, I don't want to take territory. I don't want to take Alsace-Lorraine. I don't want it. But in one of the rare times where Wilhelm I explicitly disagreed with Bismarck, it was over this issue, basically said, we have to placate the military. We have to take this territory. It's a way for us to permanently put France on the defensive and give us a huge strategic advantage over the French in any future wars. And while that was true, Bismarck's fear was that it would lead to a generation of resentment and desire for revenge on the part of the French. And he was right. You know, the seizure of Alsace-Lorraine was a horrific moment for the French, and was something that they would want to avenge, and would be a big contributor to the First World War even taking place, be a big contributor toward Franco-German relations being so poor for so long. And, you know, in that sense, Bismarck was right that taking that territory was probably not in the long-term best interests of the German Empire, although it certainly gave them a tactical advantage and put France on a defensive geographically going forward. Anyway, so that was sort of the sense of real politic which Bismarck practiced, which, again, were just, it stood for practicing politics and world politics and global politics that makes sense. And you have clear, attainable goals, a clear goal, avoid a two-front war, isolate the French, and that is your fundamental goal. And colonial politics aside, we have some colonies, but our real focus isn't there. What we really want to do is we really want to remain on the international stage as sort of an honest broker for colonial affairs, and let's just stay the hell out of the whole mess. And then then Wilhelm comes along, who we've already talked about having some inferiority issues, where he wants to be considered the equal to the British Empire, almost in sort of a Me Too type affair or Me Too type mentality. And that leads him to wanting to do a lot more than that. It leads Wilhelm into wanting to make Germany into a great empire, and more than just the continental, you know, the dominant power on the continent. And the reason that I say that Wilhelm really was focused on parity and not so much surpassing England is because he said it himself numerous times. The Kaiser multiple times basically just talked about, we want to be considered an equal, we want to be treated as an equal, and we want to basically get the respect that we think we deserve. And that was really, you know, some people kind of play it off as Germany just wanting to take over Europe, which really wasn't the case. It might have been the case for the military establishment, but that wasn't as powerful, or as, maybe not powerful is the wrong word, but that wasn't as decisive in determining Germany's future until later in the Wilhelm's reign. The goal from the political establishment and from the social establishment was to be considered an equal, be treated as an equal, and kind of they seemed to end there. Probably the most famous speech that was given regarding Germany's political views under Wilhelm occurred in 1897. In December of that year, German Foreign Secretary, so basically the Secretary of State, Bernhard von Bülow, stated, and I'm quoting here, the translation, of course, "In one word, we wish to throw no one into the shade, but we demand our own place in the sun." Germany demanded its place in the sun. Germany, this isn't just the Kaiser now. Germany as a whole had the sense of, we are being neglected, we're not getting the credit that we deserve, we are important. And we want to be recognized as being important. We want the other great powers to acknowledge our preeminence among the great powers. We want to be on par with the most powerful of them all, with England. And I think it's somewhat natural for a rising superpower, which Germany was at the time, I think it's natural for a power that had been ignored for a long time, had been neglected for a long time. I think it's natural for that people to say, wait a minute, no, now is our time. But this represented a dangerous shift in the political philosophy of Germany from real practical and pragmatic goals under Chancellor Bismarck to not really clearly defined. What does it mean to say we want to be recognized as one of the great powers? What does it mean to say we want our own place in the sun? And how do you intend to obtain that goal without throwing someone else aside? I think that's some of the questions that perhaps were not clearly thought out when expressing this policy. And this policy was called Weltpolitik, which means world policy. It was the German policy which replaced Realpolitik under Bismarck. I'm going to quote now from The Guns of August by Barbara Tuchman, because I think it sums up sort of the disconnect between Bismarck's real and practical and well-thought-out policy, which allowed Germany to expand and have unmitigated success for more than 30 years, to the policy which was promoted by the Kaiser, which led to eventually, after 20 years, Germany went from being the preeminent land power in Europe and 20 plus years of unmitigated success to 20 years of blundering around the continent, around the world, and eventually leading to the First World War, in which they were defeated. But again, I'm going to quote from The Guns of August. This is on page 8 of that book. Bismarck had warned Germany to be content with land power, but his successors were neither separately nor collectively Bismarcks. And I say successful. Going to break away here for a second. I say successors because within 2 years of Bismarck, or of Wilhelm II taking power, while he had said he admired Bismarck and his successes, Bismarck's realpolitik didn't mesh with the Kaiser's global goals. And there was a quick falling out between the two before the Kaiser eventually replaced Bismarck or convinced him to resign. The political system in Germany at the time was complex. It wasn't a strict, you know, monarchy in the sense that while Kaiser was a monarch, he didn't control everything in the country. You know, there was a chancellor who was technically in charge. But especially early in his reign, the Kaiser had tremendous power. And that was mainly in terms of appointing people. So the Kaiser would technically appoint or remove the chancellor. The Reichstag could make a recommendation, but it was not in their power to appoint the chancellor. It was up to the Kaiser. And the Kaiser, but the Reichstag had power in terms of funding. It was generally in this age kind of a rubber stamp for the imperial military Kaiser establishment. Especially in the early part of the Kaiser's reign, he did wield quite a bit of power politically. The Reichstag, again, handled a lot of the day-to-day operations there, and financing, and the Chancellor handled foreign policy and military policy and, you know, charting the direction of the country, definitely. The Kaiser wasn't a figurehead, but he also wasn't totally in charge. But what he was in charge of is picking the people to be in charge. So the Reichstag was important, the Chancellor was important, the military was important, but who were in those positions of power and ended up coming down to the Kaiser. And therefore, the Kaiser wielded quite a bit of power in Germany. If he wasn't saying exactly what things were being done, he was putting the people there in charge who were saying what things were being done. And so that's the situation in Germany in the early or late 19th century, early 20th century. The Kaiser rapidly lost power as he made blunder after blunder, and by the time of World War I, he had a lot less influence. He still appointed people, but he was more in the background. The military was making a lot more of the decisions, and the Reichstag was still kind of ending up being a rubber stamp for most issues. But I go back to that, to the quote from the book. Bismarck had warned Germany to be content with land power, but his successors, Bismarck's successors, that is, as chancellor, were neither separately nor collectively Bismarck's. Bismarck had pursued clearly seen goals unswervingly. They, his successors, groped for larger horizons with no clear idea of what they wanted. Holstein, who was the first chancellor after him, was a Machiavelli without a policy, who operated only on one principle, suspect everyone. Von Bülow, the foreign chancellor who I had mentioned previously, who would become the foreign secretary, that is, who would become chancellor, had no principles at all. He was slippery, lamented his... goodness, I'm butchering the quote here. Von Bülow had no principle. He was so slippery, lamented his colleague, Admiral Tirpitz, that compared to him, an eel was a leech. The flashing, inconsistent, always freshly inspired Kaiser had a different goal every hour and practiced diplomacy as an exercise in perpetual motion. So, essentially, no one has any clear goals. Once Bismarck is out, once Bismarck is no longer in charge, and that happened just 2 years into the Kaiser's reign, there was no direction for German foreign policy. Everyone had this sense of there is something better for us on the horizon. There is something that we want. We want to be a global power. We want to be a world power. But no one knew what that meant or how to accomplish it. The Kaiser was feckly, and his goals changed all the time, and his chancellors seemingly incompetent. We want to be great. We want to be powerful, but we don't really know what that means. We don't really know how to obtain that. We don't know really what we're shooting for. And in that, they were the polar opposite of their very realistic and pragmatic Bismarck, who he saw a goal, he knew how to accomplish it, and he went for it. Tangible, clear objectives. And that's a danger, and that's where the falling out between Britain and Germany really begins, because that's when Germany no longer is practicing foreign policy that makes sense, at least to the outside world. You know, to them it makes sense. We want to be recognized as a great power, therefore we're going to get involved in, for example, Morocco, because that's what great powers do. But to the rest of the world, it doesn't make sense. It seems like, okay, this is just Germany trying to expand at our expense. It's not that they're trying to be unequal to us. They're not respecting us. How can we respect them if they don't respect us? How can, you know, how does a sensible, responsible empire do these types of things? And there were lots of instances like that. So, you know, with this transition to Weltpolitik away from Realpolitik, you start to see some of the instances which caused Germany and England to fall out. That was the whole point of this discussion 20 minutes in, is how do Germany and Britain fall out? How do they become rivals? Whereas I said in my first part of this, last video, I talked about how in 1890 the two sides were very close. They were very good, you know, trading partners. Both sides had pretty positive opinions of each other. And what happened? Well, there were several instances. I think probably the first big one, Wilhelm didn't have a whole lot of good examples of him being successful on the diplomatic scene. And part of that was probably what Tuchman talked about, his new goal every hour. He couldn't stay focused on a topic long enough to achieve it. But one of the first ones was certainly during the Boer War, when the British were fighting the Boers, the Second Boer War. During the Second Boer War, the British were in the midst of a fight against a couple of republics in the Transvaal, which is basically in South Africa. There was a lot of gold that had been discovered there. And in 1899, a second conflict between the two had erupted. There was one previous to that, about 20 years before that. These two small countries were basically resettled. I don't know a lot about the Boers. I believe they were Dutch settlers from when South Africa was part of the Dutch Empire at one point in time. And basically they were fiercely independent, fiercely decentralized in their rule, a very sort of independent people, very well armed, and also scorn to authority. They kind of were, it's kind of like a kingdom formed in the Wild West, if you will. And I'm not really a kingdom, but you know what I say. And so gold had been discovered there several years previous, and it was a lot of gold. It was by far the biggest gold mine in the world. And they were surrounded on most sides, with one exception, some Portuguese colonies in Mozambique, I believe it was. They were surrounded mostly by the British. So all of this gold was basically in the right next to these British colonies in southern Africa. And they were an interior colony. They were landlocked, by the way. So while it was in part of present-day South Africa, it was not along the coast. The British owned the coast. So there was a conflict which basically erupted. There were a lot of British subjects and citizens who would go there to work, and there were a lot of laws and regulations passed by these Boer farmers and people who lived there to try and protect their republic from outside influence. There were basically anti-immigration rules which said, sure, you can come work here, but you can never become a citizen, essentially. And this led to a lot of indignation, and the people there were treated very poorly. The immigrants there were treated very poorly, and a lot of them were poor blacks who were subjects of the British Crown, and a lot of them were British as well as people from all over Europe. So eventually the British wanted this territory. They wanted it to help further their goal of a transcontinental, or not, yeah, well, I guess it would be transcontinental railway from Cairo to the Cape in South Africa, and the proposed railway would run through the Boer Republics, and that wasn't feasible if it wasn't part of Britain. And also the British wanted the gold, and they also, you know, they seized upon the political expediency of this conflict between, the immigrants and the settlers. So a war erupted, and in the initial phases of the war, the British suffered tremendously. It was kind of a precursor to World War One, in that the British were marching up in bright, shiny uniforms, and the Boers were in thick formations, and the Boers were dispersed in almost skirmish-like formations in dark-colored uniforms. They used the terrain, they used the weapons, and they mowed the British down, and they had a lot of initial success. And where Germany comes in this is... The Germans sent a telegram. The Kaiser denies that it was his idea or that he composed the telegram itself. But the Germans sent a telegram called the Kruger Telegram, which stated that after a Boer victory, the Jameson raid, I believe is what it was in response to, the initial foray of actually British colonists before the British military even really got directly involved. This was kind of a private band, a private military. But the Kaiser sent a telegram to him saying, "I express to you my sincere congratulations that you and your people, without appealing to help of friendly powers, have succeeded by your own energetic action against the armed bands which invaded your country as disturbers of the peace, in restoring peace, in maintaining the independence of the country against attack from without." Now, that was taken as a slap in the face to the British public, widely regarded as German support for the Boers, in basically a violation of the British sphere of influence. And this is something you don't generally do, you know, if especially empires of the time. If you have an area that's firmly in your sphere of interest, you're fighting against an enemy that's firmly in your sphere of influence, and suddenly a foreign power starts meddling in and sending congratulatory telegrams, which might imply their willingness to assist in the future, that's a pretty big deal. And the Kaiser denied it after the war, saying that it was the Foreign Office's decision, not his own. Essentially, it was something that the British became very offended at, and helped to begin to bring the relations between the British and the Germans down from their previous high points, which at that time would have been about 10 years previous. Now, the Kaiser ended up apologizing one way or the other, writing a letter essentially to Queen Victoria saying that never was the telegram intended as a step against England or your government. It was something the Germans backtracked from, but it was hard to backtrack from publicly supporting and basically offending the British, you know, publicly supporting the Boers and offending the British. That was one of those things that it essentially would have been the same thing as if... The United States, I hate to use this example because obviously a lot of people were opposed to the Iraq war, but let's say in the middle of the war against Afghanistan, there was some tremendous defeat for the United States military. Let's say a base was overrun and 20,000, not 20,000, but let's say a base was overrun and 1,000 American soldiers were slain and defeated and the U.S. had to retreat. If something like that had happened, and then... I don't want to use Germany as an example. Let's say England comes out. Let's say they're uninvolved in the war. England's an ally, so that's a bad example. What would be a good example? We're allied to so many countries. Goodness. Let's say China comes out and says, congratulations to the Taliban and whatever, or whoever we're fighting and whoever beats us. Great job on defeating these foes. Great job defending yourself. And hey, by the way, we might be willing to support you. I think a lot of people will get really, really upset at China for that. And that's one of those things you don't just quickly forgive. And so that's kind of not really the beginning, but it certainly played a part in the beginning to the separation between the British and the Germans. That happened about 10 years after the Kaiser came to power. It wasn't the first thing that begun the falling out of the two nations, but it was certainly one of them. You know, obviously Germany rising to prominence economically is gonna bring it with it some angst and some disaffection with Germany now threatening British interests, either directly or indirectly, by becoming an economic power. But it was the beginning of a steady downward trend in German-British relationships. In 1898, the German fleet was very small, and the German Navy had passed a law, the first naval law, which would see Germany for the first time begin to expand its Navy into a more global reach. Germany had at the time four Brandenburg-class battleships, which were really their only first-of-the-line battleships. They also had some coastal battleships either being built or under construction or recently constructed. I can't remember. I think they had 8 of them total, so they had about 12 total battleships in their fleet. Some of those might not have been, you know, I don't think all those were finished yet. But the first naval law called for the construction of 7 more battleships, or no, sorry, called for the construction of... Yeah, the Germans had 9 battleships at the time, 4 Brandenburgs, 5 coastal battleships. And the first naval law, which was passed in Germany in 1898, called for the construction of 7 more, bringing the fleet to 16 battleships. So it was the first real effort in the Kaiser's other dream of becoming a global power, because the Kaiser viewed a global power being required as a, to be a global power required having a strong navy. And traditionally the Germans had a very strong army and relied almost entirely on that for their own policies, and that was kind of a policy that Bismarck approved and followed. And the conservative elements in the German military and German politics really didn't want to spend a whole bunch of money on a navy. If you look at Germany's geography, an army is obviously more important than a navy. It's not traditionally a naval power, but the Kaiser, as I mentioned in the previous video, with his own ties to England, with his family ties to England, really kind of was jealous and envious of the British Navy and wanted a Navy for his own. It's kind of like a kid having a toy, wanting a toy that his friend has because it's so cool. So they passed this first naval law, and, you know, okay, 16 battleships, it sounds like a tremendous amount to us. But at the time, the British Navy was twice the size of the next two largest navies combined, that being the Russian and the French navies. And so 16 battleships wouldn't have changed that standard. The British had, by law, adopted a policy called a two-power standard, in which they would maintain a navy the size of the two next navies combined. And while Germany dramatically increasing its fleet to 16 battleships wasn't really a concern to them, because they still would have been smaller than the French Navy, and it wouldn't have changed the size that the British Navy needed to be. It would have been roughly on par, a little bit bigger probably than the Russian Navy, certainly smaller than the Russian Navy after 1905, when they lost to the Japanese in the Russo-Japanese War. But anyway, so that would have made the Germans a more powerful battle fleet, certainly capable against the Russians to defend their own coast, and more well-suited to fight the French, but not in any way able to fight the British, who at their peak would end up having 58 battleships, a mind-boggling number. These are capital ships, too. We're not talking about smaller cruisers and whatnot. But during the Boer War, as we already mentioned, initially the Kruger telegram obviously raised a firestorm. But that wasn't the only thing that happened. In 1900, the British Navy stopped 2 or 3 German mail ships that they suspected of carrying arms and munitions, possibly through Portugal, Mozambique, to the Boers. And maybe this was in response to the Kruger telegram, thinking that Germany would be willing to support the Boers. Why exactly the British did it, I'm not sure. The British quickly apologized. The ships were not carrying contraband. They were not in any way supporting the Boers. They were just German ships around. Germany had one of the largest merchant marines, so having merchant ships all over the world is something that they already had. Well, the Germans were outraged, and Admiral Tirpitz, who was a big proponent of a strong German fleet, seized upon that opportunity to propose a dramatic expansion in the German Navy. At the time, the German fleet, the first law approved a 16 battleship or fleet, but by 1900, the Germans actually had 19 battleships. Or the fleet was planning to have 19 battleships. So it had been slightly expanded upon. The second naval law called for doubling that to 38 battleships, a tremendous expansion in the Navy. And this really alarmed the British. It was kind of that first serious challenge to British naval supremacy in decades. And from a battleship standpoint, the French had adopted a policy of, I can't even remember the name of it. It was like Encol... so or something like that, and I know I'm butchering the pronunciation, but basically the idea of beating the British through cruisers. So you build up a whole bunch of cruisers that are able to raid British commerce, and you strangle them out that way with cruising ships, as opposed to fighting them on, you know, decisive naval battles. And while that's scary, and the prospect of a conflict is terrifying for business in that sense, because you can't get anything done if you can't trade, it isn't the same as saying we'll destroy your navy and therefore destroy your ability to defend yourselves. And that's kind of what that challenge of Tirpitz was, you know, the second naval law, bringing about the doubling of the size of the German navy. So that was that first alarm bell. And again, you know, this the Second Boer War really marks that beginning of a dramatic downturn in its own navy. You know, throughout the 1890s, Britain had been building up its own fleet to a massive scale, and its own battleships had been the pinnacle of battleship construction. But they were much more preoccupied with France and Russia, which they viewed as more of enemies, while they viewed Germany more as an ally, or at least a strong trading partner. But the second naval law, in just a few years, proposing doubling the size of the German fleet, and also dealing with the antagonistic German response to the Boers, was a shift in the wrong direction, and things started rapidly going bad for German and British relations. I believe it was Lord Salisbury read to the British cabinet and parliament on November 15th of 1901. The naval policy of Germany is definite and persistent. The emperor seems determined that the power of Germany shall be used all over the world to push German commerce, German possessions, and interests. Of necessity, it follows that German naval strength must be raised so as to compare more advantageously than at present with ours. The result of this policy will be to place Germany in a commanding position if ever we find ourselves at war with France and Russia. Naval officers who have seen much of the German navy lately are all agreed that it is as good as it can be. And then a cabinet paper in 1902 stated the more the composition of the new German fleet is examined, the clearer it becomes that it is designed for a possible conflict with the British fleet. It cannot be designed for the purpose of playing a leading part in a future war between Germany and France and Russia. The issue of such a war can only be decided by armies on land, and the great naval expenditure on which Germany has embarked involves deliberate diminution of the military strength which Germany might otherwise have attained in relation to France or Russia. So basically, the British, suddenly with this dramatic fleet, you know, if you build 16 battleships, you can easily say you're only going to be using them to defend yourself against the French and British, because they both, or the French and the Russians, because that's, you know, their fleets are bigger than that. But if you're on the defensive on the naval aspect, it'll at least potentially keep the seaways open and commerce open. But if you're building 38 battleships when you could be building 16 battleships and 20 infantry divisions, you're basically intentionally reducing the size of your army. You're trading off the size of your army for the size of your navy when your principal opponents are not going to be coming at you mainly through the navy. So naturally, the British view it as a response. And it ends up beginning that shift of British foreign policy away from considering Germany as a more of a friend than an enemy to being a threat. And Tirpitz's own proposals on how a German fleet would be used don't help matters. His whole risk fleet assessment is very directed against the British. And so that again causes policies to begin to shift as well, even more away toward Germany. It also doesn't help that in 1900, during the Boxer Rebellion, when there was an anti-Western uprising in China, that the Kaiser kind of put his foot in his mouth and certainly said some things that were considered somewhat barbaric and jaw-dropping to the rest of the world. He gave a speech as his troops were about to go off to China, in which he said, "Should you encounter the enemy, he will be defeated. No quarter will be given. Prisoners will not be taken. Whoever falls into your hands is forfeited. Just as 1,000 years ago the Huns under the King of Attila made a name for themselves, one that even today makes them seem mighty in history and legend, may the name German be affirmed by you in such a way in China that no Chinese will ever dare to look cross-eyed at a German." So, not only is this a little bit racist, but it's also extremely, extremely aggressive and considered barbaric, you know, in this age of civilized imperialism, in which perhaps evil or certainly malicious intent is disguised with clever and kind wording. That was not the case of the Kaiser in the way he spoke. He was very bellicose and put his foot in his mouth quite often. And that is one of those things where it's this good example right there of the Kaiser just not having any sense of tact or diplomacy. And You know, I think that that's another good example of an incident in which Germany was no longer the calm, rational, reasoned, Bismarckian, realistic political affiliator. They're just out there doing, saying whatever without any real goal or sense of where this is headed. And really, I mean, this is just another example, and this is just an example of kind of the way that the Kaiser operated in general, in that he didn't seem to have a sense of the importance of words and politics and the damage that he could do, either intentionally or unintentionally. I don't think the Kaiser was as belligerent or intentionally boneheaded as people make him out to be. He almost just seems like a child who's in charge of this country, and he's he wants things, and he does them, and he doesn't consider the impact. It's he had training as a soldier. He didn't really have training as a diplomat. While apparently Bismarck had tried to train him growing up, he didn't seem to operate under a real diplomatic sense. And this was, these are just two examples. The naval expansion would continue, and he kept talking about the need of Germany to have a fleet. Tirpitz's own policy and other policies by people in Germany and the policy put out by the German Navy clearly identified England as the most likely enemy in a case of a war. And if you're Britain, all of a sudden you've got this enemy building up this massive fleet, which can really only have one potential enemy because it's the second largest fleet in the world. So who else are they going to fight unless Germany is going to swipe the French colonies, which Germany can already beat the French on land. They can already beat the Russians on land. You don't need a navy to do that. They proved that in 1870 where they crushed the French and they didn't need a navy. And even if you want to build your fleet up more so that you don't have to worry as much about a navy, in the case of a protracted war, you don't need it to be as large as they were building it. And they just kept kind of blundering about. The Moroccan crisis in 1905, basically Wilhelm decided to visit Tangier in Morocco on his own yacht, which was considered part of the French sphere of influence. And he gave a speech there, even seeming to indicate that Germany would support Moroccan independence from France. It was very uncolonial, unimperialistic, and unrealistic as well. And so, naturally the British go in and they're going to back the French because, the French represent the colonial order. They're respecting the colonial traditions. You don't do this. You don't go into someone else's territory. You don't go into someone else's backyard and say, no, you people, you deserve to be independent. Kind of like the Germans almost did with the Boers, and now we're doing it with the Moroccans, and therefore the British are going to stand up because they don't want to set a precedent of anyone being able to go into anyone else's backyard and take colonies or support the independence of other colonies. So the British back the French, and again, that's an example of the British and French kind of being driven into each other's camps by the Kaiser's own incompetence. The Daily Telegraph Affair was another example of where the Kaiser basically put his own foot in the mouth. He gave an interview to the Daily Telegraph, which was an English publication, which the entire intent was to, in his mind, kind of console the English and bring the English and Germans closer together and make them feel like, listen, I'm really out here for you. I really like you guys. You guys are family. I want this entire entire world. I want a relationship between our countries to be good and positive. And he doesn't know how to say it. He doesn't know how to be diplomatic about it. I mean, he was having this conversation, this interview with this, this British newspaper about, German and English relations. And the Kaiser says, and I quote, "You English are mad. Mad as March hares. What has come over you that you're so completely given over to suspicion, quite unworthy of a great nation? What more can I do than I have done? I declared with all the emphasis at my command in my speech at Guildhall that my heart is set upon peace and that is one of my dearest wishes to live on the best terms with England. Have I ever been false to my word? Falsehood and prevarication are alien to my nature. My actions ought to speak for themselves, but you listen not to them, but to those who misinterpret and distort them. That is the great personal insult which I feel and resent. To be forever misjudged, to have my repeated offers of friendship weighed and scrutinized with jealous, mistrustful eyes, taxes my patience severely. I have said time after time, that I am a friend of England and your press, or at least a considerable section of it. Bids the people of England refuse my proffered hand and insinuate the other holds a dagger? How can I convince a nation against its will? So, I mean, he's speaking down to the British people. He's insulting them. He's talking about how offended he is by them. But basically, in talking about how he wants peace and prosperity and friendship, he's doing it in a very patronizing and offensive way. He doesn't stop there. I repeat, and it doesn't help either. He doesn't stop there. I repeat that I am a friend of England, but you make things difficult for me. My task is not of the easiest. The prevailing sentiment among large sections of the middle and lower classes of my own people is not friendly to England. I am therefore to speak a minority in my own land, but it is a minority of the best elements as it is in England with respect to Germany. That is another reason why I resent your refusal to accept my pledged word that I am a friend of England. I strive without ceasing to improve relations, and you retort that I am your arch enemy, and you make it hard for me. Why is it? So again, it almost sounds like a child complaining that he's not getting things the way that he wants them. It's not a diplomatic way to go about things. Worst of all, it comes off of saying Germans hate the British. That's how he comes off. He's like, oh, well, I want to have good relations with Britain. My people might not want to, but I do. So again, it creates the sense that Germans don't like the British, and all of a sudden you're basically saying, my people hate you, but I'm trying to stand up for you. That doesn't create positive relations. That deteriorates relations. And again, it comes off him as being a petulant child, not getting what he wants and being upset about it. It doesn't come off as a diplomat seriously trying to improve relations. That was a huge disaster. He got a ton of criticism in Germany from it. He got a ton of criticism in Britain from it. And really, this is kind of the culmination of things where the Kaiser really lost a lot of the influence and power that he had in German politics. And after 1908, after that Daily Telegraph affair, the Kaiser was really I wouldn't say he wasn't in charge, because he wasn't really in charge for a lot of the time before that, and he still appointed people to be in charge, but he lost a lot of influence. He was a much more powerful monarch in the early days of his reign than in the later days of his reign. And it's because the Daily Telegraph affair wasn't the only incident of embarrassment. He had begun losing a lot of his power in 1907. There was a crisis or controversy called the Hardin-Uhlenberg affair, which is basically an affair between a German general and some other people who were kind of in the Kaiser's own entourage, if you will. And there was this big ordeal that was more of an internal crisis. It didn't really impact German-British relations, but it definitely caused the Kaiser to lose a lot of standing in Germany because of some of the prejudices against homophobia. I guess that's the wrong way to say it. There was a lot of prejudice against homosexuals in Germany, and this homophobia helped cause the Kaiser to lose some standing because one of his military aides turned out was having an affair with another top German official. And so it was really a disaster for the Kaiser. And between that and between the Daily Telegraph affair and the Germans, you know, they don't like being talked down upon as well. And the spat that came up of it wasn't very negative. The Kaiser basically became secluded and had some psychological trauma and issues with overcoming that that whole crisis that really affected him personally and kind of caused him to go from being this very confident, very carefree, jovial kind of guy to very reserved and very quiet, and you know, he suffered psychologically. He may have had some serious psychological damage done as a result of that, but so I mean, these are just some events which really helped shift British public opinion away from being friends, and they're examples, but they're definitely not the only cases where the Germans come off as being incredibly hostile to British interests. And so I just wanted to talk about those a little bit. I mean, these are some of the quick hits, some of the real big influencing factors which changed British public opinion from being pro-Germany to being against Germany in a relatively short period of time, a couple of decades. Now, I intended for these videos to be about a half an hour long. I didn't want to make the whole why did the British and Germans fall out affair to be too much. You know, I didn't want to make it too long. I wanted to make it really just two episodes. So I know that, this one was Oh, almost an hour long, about 50 minutes. So I appreciate you sticking with me here. You can see the situation in this game. I did less talking about the game than I wanted, more talking about history than I wanted. So not going to be the norm for this series, but let me know what you think about it. Yeah, I'm going to pull the episode off here. In Turkey, things are still going okay. The Russian invasion's now cut off. The Austrians, meanwhile, are holding their own near Premzil. And Serbia is in danger as my forces kind of filter through their lines. The French, meanwhile, on the Western Front, as you can see here if you've been watching, are filling through on the West flank as well. The Western Front as well, so things are not going great there either. We've held a strong line along Belgium, but in southern France, they're kind of slowly invading Germany there. And on the Eastern Front, the Russian horde is overwhelming us and destroying us. Slowly but surely, we're being overwhelmed there. So that's going to do it for this episode. I know right now we're in the AI turn period here. I hope this was informative and I didn't just brush over things too quickly. I know it seems superficial, kind of some of the things that turned the British off, but the Boer conflict, that was a huge thing. The German naval laws would only make things worse, as Germany's navy was clearly being built up to challenge the British, as now the British are throwing us back here in Belgium as well. So things are looking really bad for us right now. They got four French units threatening Stuttgart fully through our lines. Things are bad. In Belgium, the British just drove us back. Our lines are disintegrating there. About the only place that things are going well for us right now is in Serbia, where we're nearly cutting off two Serbian garrisons in the south and filtering through the lines very effectively. Meanwhile, in eastern Prussia, the Russians are overwhelming us again, slowly but surely, and Berlin could be threatened before too long, so things are not going well. But I hope this was an informative discussion about the Kaiser and about kind of how those relations began to shift. These were not the only things by any means, but they were some of the big events which occurred, which really helped to turn British public opinion against the Germans, which then obviously influenced the politicians, who then started drawing closer to France. Because before all of these issues, France and Russia were considered the big threats. And now all of a sudden Germany's got the second largest navy and is talking about basically how our countries don't like each other, and is talking about supporting the enemies of our country and doing a lot of things which immediately are going to turn you off against them. So certainly understandable that the British would not view those German actions friendly and would cause them to start shifting their opinion of the Germans from being friends to being enemies. And those were some of the big events that did it. And they also eroded the Kaiser's power. He went from being a relatively very powerful monarch to rapidly losing power in the face of the military establishment, who took basically less and less care of what the Kaiser wanted or had to say or do, and the establishment became more and more concerned about its own political desires. He certainly wasn't out of power by 1908, but he didn't have the same influence or power as he did in the early or late 1890s. So anyway, folks, I hope you enjoyed this video. Let me know what you think. Let me know if you want more of this. Let me know if you want more talk about the gameplay. As you can see here, Eastern Prussia is a mess. Danzig and Königsberg are in serious trouble. If I don't stop them there, I don't have any troops between them and Berlin. So hopefully I stop the Russians, because they're the ones who are going to beat me right now. But then again, in France, as I said, four units through, things are looking down in France. This is a tough game, in my opinion, to play as the Central Powers. I really feel like Russia has a bit of a buff. I feel like their units attack far too effectively. You can defeat them when you're attacking them, but the Russian units on the attack seem like they get some kind of buff or perk. You know, it's like, oh, well, they're the Russians, we got to give them an attack bonus because they're manpower or something. That's almost what it feels like. I don't know if that's the case, but that's what it feels like. The problem with that is they already have so many more units than you that they get kind of like a double perk for manpower, if that's the case. Again, I'm assuming that. I don't know, however. It just seems that way, that they're so effective on the attack. But I guess we'll see where things go. We're starting to bypass the Serbians, surround the Serbians, and hopefully defeat the Serbians here. So I might be able to free up a whole bunch of Austrian units to go north and fight the Russians if we win here shortly. As we just took whatever that port was, and now that kicked that French cruiser out of port. And now, because we took that port, that French cruiser is in our own friendly territory, and just got sunk. Booyah! But anyway, so that's going to do it for this video here. I appreciate you tuning in. I hope you enjoyed. Let me know what you think. Let me know if this is not something you enjoyed or if this is something that maybe you think I should do more of. But until next time, that's going to be it for this episode. This is the Historical Gamer saying thank you for watching. Leave comments, likes, all of that stuff in the description. Let me know what you want to see going forward. And until next time, the Historical Gamer here saying thank you for watching, and I'm out.